experiencing God's peace.
All right.
Experiencing God's peace. In this life, brothers and sisters, we all face storms. Some of our storms are physical. Some of our storms are emotional. Some of our storms are spiritual. Other storms are vocational. Other storms are even educational. But brothers and sisters, I'm so happy this morning that God gives us a word that lets us know that storms does not have the last word in our lives. When we look at our text today, Paul was writing not to folks who were outside of the church. He was not writing to folks who were unsaved, but he was writing to folks with reverend in front of their name. Folks who were stewards and trustees and class leaders and stewardesses and ushers and choir members. He was writing to the people of God. Encouraging us to experience God's peace.
All right. All right.
Now, brothers and sisters, we have an enemy to God's peace. That enemy is anxiety. That enemy is worry. That enemy is frustration. That enemy is confusion. That enemy is trash that often enters into our minds to try to tell us that we are not who God says we are. But brothers and sisters, God wants to remind us today that the gift of peace is marvelous. The gift of peace is wonderful, and the gift of peace is transformative. Now, some people believe that we can only have peace when things are going well in our lives. Others believe we can only have peace when we are employed. Others believe we can only have peace when we know how we're going to pay our bills. Others believe we can have peace when there's no confusion in our homes, in our workplace, or even in our church. But brothers and sisters, let me remind you, now don't miss this. Paul wrote this letter while he was in prison. Isn't it amazing that the brother would encourage the church to have peace while he was there in prison, facing an impending death? Here he is encouraging the body of Christ to experience the peace of God. We saw in verse 2 and 3 that he was encouraging them to have peace, that even while the church was going through a period of confusion. You see, the two sisters were going at it. There was conflict in the body of Christ. And some people believe that there can only be peace when everything is in harmony. But listen, I'm here to tell you this morning that that is simply a tool of the enemy. Because life will never be of the sort when everything is going right in everything. Somebody missed that. Life is never the kind of thing where everything goes right in everything. You won't always agree with everything your spouse says. So if you're waiting for peace in your marriage, don't wait for everything to be right. I'm speaking to somebody this morning. If you're waiting for peace on your job, don't wait for your boss to do everything your way. If you're in your own business, don't wait for everything to be lined up perfectly for all the sales to take place. But what God is saying to us this morning, on the second day of October, 2011, no matter what is going on in your life, God wants to give you peace. Now, I want to put a point there, and I want you to follow me now. In verse 7 sudden, the word says that we don't understand God's peace.
Yes.
Because the word says it surpasses. Somebody say surpasses. It surpasses all. Somebody say all. Understanding. Now, when I looked at that, that just simply blew my mind. That means that when God gives you peace, folk won't understand why you're not falling apart. They won't understand why you are not being out of shape. They won't understand why you are not about to lose your mind. They might make you on some kind of medication. Don't get me wrong, medication is all right.
Yeah.
I'm here to tell you, it's all right.
Yeah.
Because sometimes we do need help to make it in this life.
Yeah.
The life comes at us fast. And it can put us on a downward spiral in a hurry.
Yeah.
But I'm here to tell you, beloved, that peace.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
God's peace.
Yeah.
Does not always make sense.
Yes. Yes.
And then secondly now, God's peace will guard our hearts and minds. Come here, Reverend Graham, and stand right here.
Yeah.
Come here, Reverend Will, and stand right here. When we have God's peace, then God's peace will guard our minds. Reverend Graham is like a security guard. When the devil tries to come and blow our minds, we can get behind the God. For everything behind God, we will stand guard 24/7.
Hallelujah.
And then God's peace will guard our hearts.
Yeah.
Everything can't come into your heart. But God's peace will guard it. You told me about the peace. You told me it's beyond my human comprehension. And you told me it would guard my mind and my heart. But then I can hear you saying, well, preacher, you haven't really preached until you tell me how I can get that peace.
All right.
I can hear somebody saying, you haven't said absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
Unless you give me the answer to uncovering God's peace.
Yes. Yes.
Well, I don't have the answer, but it's right here in the Word. And really now, when you look at it, it really preaches itself. God's peace now, and let me say this. In the Gospel of John, and I don't have time to unpack all of it, but in the Gospel of John, two types of peace are lifted. Our peace on the one hand, and God's peace on the other.
All right.
The problem with our peace is that it comes with outward circumstances.
Yeah.
Everything has to be in place for our peace to reign.
Well, mercy, Father, mercy.
But God's peace is something that is beyond happiness, beyond having our way, beyond what we can simply understand.
Yeah.
For God's peace, number one, comes as a result of joy.